So we have a four-year strategic plan for the district, and I hope you've seen it before. It's the I am prepared, I am well, I am engaged pillars. And in that, every year we concentrate on some key goals, which will get us to the completion of a four-year plan. And so we took the one-year goals, which is called the director's work plan, to the board last night and presented them. And some of the work is really about deepening the work in our district. Equity is still a key priority area. It's the way we do our work. So it's through the lens of equity. And it's we have a new term. It's called culturally responsive and relevant and sustaining pedagogy, CRRSP for short. And what that means is that students can see themselves reflected in the examples, in the content, in the resources, in the books that are selected for, as teaching resources in their classrooms. And that means that kids, when they see themselves reflected in the curriculum that their teacher's teaching, they have a greater sense of belonging and a greater sense of autonomy and connection with the school. And of course, their morale is built because the teacher is using examples from maybe their history and connecting it to kids' real lived experiences. So that's exciting work. And so we're deepening the areas for our elementary students with a particular focus on literacy and math. And in secondary, we're really looking at the area of assessment. And so we have a lot of goals, and I would encourage you, they'll be up on the board website. It's called the Director's Work Plan again. And I won't go through all of them tonight, but that's some core work for the year ahead. This year is also the last year of our current strategic plan. So we collect a lot of different information and data throughout the year. We call it, we have three terms. We call it satellite data, map data, and street data. And Jane's going to talk a little bit about some of the data we're collecting tonight, so I won't steal her thunder. But at the satellite level, so that's really high up, we're looking at things like EQAO results, which really help us in terms of trends over time. So we can look to see our elementary students, because of course it's not the same kids writing the test every year, and it's a different test every year. So it's not comparable. But if over the number of years, the psychometricians look at the kinds of questions and the results that kids are producing, and they can score those results to say, all right, so, you know, last year your board scored at this level, And next year you're going up, and the next year you're going up ultimately. So of course, that test is done at grades 3, 6, 9, and 10. So grade 3 and 6, it's reading, writing, and math. And grade 9, it's math. And grade 10, it's the literacy test, which is required for graduation. So that's the kind of big picture data that we use to kind of take stock of our district. At the map level are things like report card marks. Well, how are kids doing in a whole class of students? How are all the grade 3s doing in a particular school in reading? And of course, we have that data more readily available because we have a few report card times during the school year. It's not just a one time in the example of EQAO, which is once a year. And then street data is when we're working with particular students and looking at their results to make sure that they're being individually successful. So when we build a new strategic plan, which we're going to do this year, we're looking at all of that those different levels of data. We're starting to look at our district to say who's being successful in our district, who is struggling, which groups of kids do we need to focus in on, what are the services and supports that we need to set the conditions for learning. And then we start to look at also the province's plan. And this year, the province has some indicators that they are going to be also posting for every board in the province. And that mostly is at the satellite level, so really high level data. And that compares also attendance rates and some interest surveys from students, like do they feel well prepared for things? And we don't know exactly how they expect us to collect that yet. But all of that data we start to analyze, and then we gather some input from parents and staff to identify what's working, what would parents like to see happening in our district, and that helps to lend itself then to the whole process of a new strategic plan for the next 4 years. So that's a big project at the system level that we'll be working on throughout the course of the year. The other thing I would like to just tell you is that a lot of we're returning this year to a lot more professional learning. We know that when we invest in all levels of our organization for different roles, that has a direct impact on students and their families. And so that is something that we're really pleased to bring back in a bigger way as we've come out of a pandemic and we're getting more into a regular school year. So that's exciting. There's so much going on. I think I just want to also mention to you that we also have, we recognize that safe schools is always a priority. When students are safe at school, then they feel, you know, then we can attain the other two areas around preparedness and wellness and also engagement. But we need kids to come to school and feel safe first. So we're taking a deeper look at school plans this year to identify what are some key things we can continue to do to keep it on the front burner, safety as, trying new different projects and pilots all the time to increase safety. Because it continues to be something that's newsworthy across the province, that violence, as we still see a lot of dysregulation in people, and violence continues to be, student violence is something that we're still always working against, as well as mental health and well-being. So there's a lot of resources still being put into the mental health and well-being work. So the other thing I will share with you is at the board meeting last night, I also took my letter of retirement. So I have given the board lots of notice. My contract will finish and I will retire in August 2024. And I just want to say that it's been just such a pleasure and a great opportunity to lead this board. And I've been really invested in the work. I'm still very excited about what we're going to do in this year ahead. But I thought I would mention that so you heard it first from me that that is my intention after this coming school year. So thank you, everyone. And I'm happy to answer any questions if you have any. Okay, well, I'll be online here in case you have any other later on. Thanks.
Thank you, Lisa. That's big news and you will be missed for sure, but I'm glad we have you for at least another year. So next on the agenda is just a bit of an update from the Foundation for Education. So that's my hat as well. So I'm the executive director at the Foundation for Education. For those of you that know who the foundation is, wonderful. For those of you that are new and would like to learn more, by all means, please feel free to visit our website, foundationforeducation.ca. The main point of talking tonight is just to remind everybody as you're planning out your fundraising for the year, there's opportunities to connect with the foundation to help with your fundraising. So we had someone from Little Falls call me. They were able to donate $1,000, and through their company, because we're a registered charity, they're able to get a matching $1,000. So because of that, the school is able to get $2,000. So there's all kinds of company and programs. Some people get paid for their volunteer hours. Some people, have the ability to apply for grants, through their work and different programs, but it all has to be done through a registered charity. So that's one of the advantages of working with us. The other thing is if you let your, when you're hosting an event and you let them know that, hey, a registered charity is connected to this and we can offer a charitable tax receipt, you might find that you end up with more donations. So my daughter goes to Avon Public School. We do a glow dance night where it's enter by donation. So someone can enter the door, with 50 cents. But because we also let them know that it's a fundraiser and an opportunity to donate for a tax receipt, we had somebody come with a $500 check because they had the ability to match with their corporation and stuff. So there's lots of ways that we can help. Last year, we weren't as efficient at getting the money transferred back to the school as fast as I'd like. The good news, we're set up this year with a new staff to support me so that things should be done twice a month going forward and staying caught up and up to date. So that's a little bit of an update from the foundation. Are there any questions? Okay, that's great. Next is our parent caregiver survey, and that is Jane Morris.
Hi there, everybody. Hopefully you can hear me. I've recently had a little bit of a change in my portfolio. So part of my portfolio now holds data and research. And so that's the hat that I'm wearing when I'm coming to you this evening. Our data and research department is responsible for administering a school climate survey every second year to all stakeholders in the organization. So students were completed last spring, and this fall we'll be launching the parent and caregiver survey as well as the staff survey. And our plan is to have both of those surveys ready to come out in the month of November, which is why I'm here with you this evening, so I can kind of let you know that that's coming, and that that will be coming to you through your school principals in November. I'm hoping for the first week of November. For those of you that are also staff members, you'll be receiving a link as a staff member. But for the purpose of this conversation, we're talking about parent and caregiver surveys. That survey has two parts. The first part asks the parent or the caregiver to describe their own experience while interacting with the school. And they're asked to identify what school they're referencing. So for those of you that are, you know, you have kids in different schools, the survey will loop around based on how many children that you have in the system and if they're in different buildings. So it asks you to describe your own personal experience interacting with the school and providing us some feedback around that experience. And then it'll ask you to describe your child's experience while interacting with the school and the school staff. And these are all questions related to the sense of belonging, safety, and how your experience and your child's experience has how you've experienced those pieces. And the intention of both of these surveys, both the staff and the parent one, taken in conjunction with the student data, will come back to the school teams to develop action plans. Because each school looks a little bit different, right? And so the context of the school, while we can look at it from the district perspective and consider, you know, what actions from a district perspective we need to attend to, it's really important that our schools build and they have safe schools teams in every school, that those teams are looking at that data, anonymous data, that will help them consider what they need to be attending to and thinking about. And I know when we were looking at the student data through the summer, there's some really interesting observations from kids, and there's some, you know, simple things that schools can be thinking about. And then there's more complex challenges that they're going to have to get their heads around. And I imagine that'll be the same thing with the parent and caregiver survey data. I imagine we'll receive some feedback that, you know, we will say things like, oh, why didn't we think of that? That's a easy thing for us to consider and think about. And then there's probably going to be other issues that are bigger issues that the school staff are going to have to really attend to by spending some time thinking about what are we going to do about this. So what I was really hoping this evening was bringing this to your attention so that when that communication comes out to your school community and folks that you know in your neighborhoods, that you can encourage people to please complete the survey. Sometimes, you know, when we ask for survey feedback, we struggle sometimes to get parent voice for sure, right? Because it is an ask on people's time. It is something sort of outside of, you know, everything else you're trying to do in the evening as a parent. But the feedback from our parent community is critical because most of our schools get some feedback, but they are not able to intentionally gather on a regular basis. So this survey every second year is an intentional strategy that makes sure that we ask every parent in the district, how are you feeling? How is your child feeling about their sense of belonging, their connection, their safety in that building? So if you can do whatever you can with the networks that you have in across Avalon Maitland to promote that survey when it comes out, that would be really appreciated. And I know the school teams would appreciate robust responses, because the more voices they have, the better they're able to get a picture of the parent community. And Shara, I don't know if you want to take a minute and maybe speak to how the communications department will take the survey tool that my team will put together, and that how you then sort of action that so that it gets, you know, moving a little bit.
Yeah, so we'll definitely take a pretty comprehensive approach to promotion of the survey. Obviously, it's easier with the staff because we have a sort of a captive audience and an internal system for promotion. But with parents, we have a few different ways to reach them. We have our school messenger email system. We, of course, will be using social media and posting the promotion on our website. We'll also probably send information to principals directly to promote in school newsletters for those that have them. And then committees like this, so PIC would be one, perhaps the Special Education Advisory Committee, the Indigenous Education Advisory Committee, some of our committees at the board level that have parent involvement, we will be promoting it through that. So anywhere that we can reach parents will be kind of where we're headed. So we'll be coming to you. We won't have our next meeting until January, so the timing won't be right for an actual meeting for this group. But what we'll be doing is we'll be sending it through our through via email, because I do communicate with this group via email, and asking that you then take the information back to school council, and then the school council share it out to the school community. So we're hoping that parents will see it in a multitude of ways. And as Jane explained, we really want to, the more feedback that we can get, the more we can do with that. And if we, the intention is to improve the student experience, which is why we're all here. So that's sort of an overview.
And the parent experience, right? Like, I think that's another piece that sometimes we need to be intentional in how we attend to that, and how parents are received and welcomed into our buildings. That's something that I know the school administration are certainly interested in hearing a little bit more about. So whatever you can do to promote that when that comes out, and I think, Shara, you'll send directly to this group, will you not?
Excellent. Are you able to take any questions at this time, Jane? Does anybody?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, happy to answer any questions.
We have a quiet group tonight. Oh, we have Shauna with her hand raised.
Yeah, I was just kind of wondering how much latitude schools have to exercise judgment when they get the results back. Like, I work in, a lot of people on this call know, I work in libraries, and one of the things we see is some really active groups of people who will try to come together as a front to push an agenda, in the sense that, you know, like the anti-LGBTQ lobby right now, they show up for everything. So we have to use our good professional judgment to kind of make sure that, you know, like we respect the religious background you've got, we've got stuff for you too, but no, we can't stop serving this other demographic. Do the schools have the latitude? Like if you get a lot of feedback from one group that is interested in maybe reducing service to another group, do you have the latitude to kind of use your good judgment and continue to move forward with equity-based stuff?
Yeah, for sure. Like, I don't think, and I know Director Walsh is on the call, so you're welcome to hop on if you want to tune up my answer or help clarify, but I think when we think about what we want to see our schools to be, are inclusive and welcoming to all communities. Okay. And in order to do that, we can't exclude or make a system or structures that would separate or negate the experience of another community. So that would be something that when the principals receive this data, one of the things we'll work through with them is how they maybe have to filter a little bit and think about how we ensure that all are represented and feeling included and welcome in the buildings. I don't know, Director Walsh, if you want to add on that.
I think you gave a perfect example. that's great. Thank you.
That's enormously reassuring. Thank you.
Thank you, Jane. There's no other questions. We can move on to the next item. And this, as a group, this is one of my favorite parts of this group, is with the topics that are shared. Shara does an excellent job working with us to get our key takeaways for reporting back to schools. It comes in a nice little summary, and I find it very easy to forward that on to the school council to be shared in the minutes. That's what we're going to work on now. So we'll take about 10 minutes and just talk about what our key takeaways are.
Laura, can I just quickly mention the mental health and well-being?
Yes.
Because I think that might hit the key takeaways. Okay. Just today, our mental health and well-being team reached out for a little bit of promotion help with what they're calling their caregiver lunch and learn. And we'll be promoting this through social media as well and on our website. But I just wanted to give you a heads up. Last year, they did a series in the spring where they did a lot of different topics. They did a technology takeover, dealing with anxiety, dealing with stress, a number of different ones. This year, they're just doing in the fall. The title is The Power of Mindful Parenting. And it's in partnership with Huron-Perth Children's Aid Society and the Huron-Perth Catholic Board. So both boards are working together with the Children's Aid, and they're running this on October 11th from 12 to 12:30. So it's meant to be online, quick, lunchtime. Parents could hopefully pop on while at work if that was the situation. So I will, there's a little flyer here, so I can include that in the key takeaways, and hopefully you'll see it as well on social media or in other spots. But I just wanted to mention that because I just heard about today, and I thought this group would want to promote that. And yes, then we can talk about key takeaways. So what we usually do is we just have people speak up or put their hand up, however you want to do it. What were the key things that kind of stood out to you? And if you weren't in the meeting, what would you really like sort of that come from that perspective of what would you want to hear about? And what were the key things that you think would be relevant to take back to the school councils and the rest of the community?
I definitely think we can start with that event that you just finished mentioning. That's good for everyone to know.
Yep.
Kirsten's got her name up, her hand up.
I think one of the key takeaways for me is that survey and how you're trying to get more parents involved. We're at a really small school. I think we only have about 160 kids from K to 8. So I'm guessing we have about 70 families. So I will really push at our school for that survey for the parents. And we have a huge school council that's really active. So knowing that you're not getting as much parent feedback as you want, that's definitely something I will try and share as much as I can to get our school family to participate.
Great, thank you. Yeah, so I'll include a little blurb about the survey, what it's all about, and timelines so that people are watching for it and then hopefully filling it out. You can, yeah, I see a few people typing. You can also put anything in the chat as well if that's easier.
The foundation information is good to know for fundraising purposes for sure, because we're starting to do our dreaming already. So
that's great. Something I didn't mention was there's different organizations that offer grants throughout the year. And so even if you have a project in mind, letting me know about it. And then when these grant opportunities come up, I can connect back with you to see if it makes sense to fill in an application. So we got 17 grants last year for schools. So, it would be great to see that pot grow. They can be for accessibility pieces on playgrounds. It can be for an after school family community connection point. It can be, for some sort of building in your back playground, outdoor learning space. There's lots of different ideas. So if you think, how do I get there selling chicken and planters and chocolate and all that kind of stuff? Sometimes a grant might be the easiest way to achieve our goals too. So keep that in mind.
Carlene, sorry, I see Carlene's question in the chat. Pro grants. Yes, I have connected with the finance team, so we will be rolling the pro grants out very soon. That's a really good point. I should have mentioned that. We're going to be following the same process as last year, so it's a really quick rollout. So I'll be able to, I should be able to send some information with the key takeaways about pro grants and that we're rolling out much sooner. Last year, we were delayed because of the changes that were occurring at the ministry level. And so we weren't really putting things out until closer to January, but this year we'll be able to get them out this fall for sure. Thank you for the reminder. And I had been waiting to hear back from them, so I'll poke them tomorrow.
We have Jenny with her hand up.
Hi, actually, I was going to ask about pro grants, but I was also going to ask about Lisa was saying about for on the elementary level, the literacy and math, that's going to be like part of the direct something or other. Sorry,
no,
my
okay.
kids were loud in the background. Yeah. But I was just curious, like, I hear her talk about these things in the beginning, but then I don't, like, I this last year was my first PIC thing, but like, I didn't see them coming into my public school and how they're being used. So I was wondering if I could make sure that I could follow up on that, because I find in our school, and especially my daughter, just with being a pandemic kindergarten grade one, she's very behind on this stuff. And I'd like to know how we're helping directly. Because I hear you talk about is helping, but I don't know how it's implemented in the schools. I'd like a follow up with that, please. Thanks.
Sure, Jenny, that's a wonderful question, actually, and probably other parents have your same question. So happy to answer that. So what I was talking about is that at the system level, that's some of the focus areas. We call it, you know, we've got our stove with all these pots and lots of them are on simmer because there's lots of work carrying on, but it's keeping going. And then we have some things that we're turning on to high heat. And that's where we're really focusing in on literacy. And we're particularly looking at literacy because we know that during the pandemic, kids slipped back, and especially our early literacy learners didn't get maybe the background or the fulsomeness. There's the student that we're talking about that we might have, you know, that they might have had. So in terms of literacy, that's a big primary focus at the system level, just as an example. So what happens from there is that each school also builds a school plan for improvement for the school year. And they're looking at their own data, their school level data, to say, okay, so, you know, this is some of our teachers are going to go out for this training in math and this training in literacy. And what does this look like for what we're going to focus in on the school level in particular areas? And so then the principal and the leadership team and the teachers design a school plan for continuous learning for the year. And so you have two options as parents. One is to ask the teacher. That would be your primary person to go to say, you know, I'm concerned about this and what does this look like in terms of growth and development this school year for my child? And what are the measures to catch my child up in these areas if you feel they are behind? And you could also ask the principal, what is the work at the school level? What are you going to be focusing in on? And a lot of you are school council members. So, you know, that's a good question to ask the principal. What are some of the things that we have in our school plan for this year ahead? Because that can involve training for the teachers and also work for students and a focus on particular learning together.
That's great. Thank you very much. I just want to make sure that when other parents ask me, I don't think parents actually know how to address it. They just hear there's going to be funding, there's going to be help, and they don't actually know. So at least now I can take this back to other concerned parents I've talked to and be like, this is what you need to do to be proactive with your kid. So thank you.
Awesome. Thank you.
I can put a little a blurb about just the director's work plan and a link to it on our website, so that if anybody's looking to sort of dig in a little bit to the details of that plan for this year, you can read more about it on the website. So I can include a link to that as well.
And while I was listening, I had someone reach out and remind me about the upcoming gala for the Foundation for Education. The foundation, since we are a charity, we have to fundraise for ourselves. We do get a sizable donation from Avon Maitland, but that doesn't cover all of our expenses. So for us to offer the enhanced learning opportunities or our caring fund, we would help purchase eyeglasses or pay for a CAP hearing test or buy snow boots for students in need. Those are things that we all have to fundraise for. So we're excited to say that we've brought back our gala in person, and it's going to be November 4th, which is the first Saturday in November. Tickets are available to be purchased online right now on our website, and all proceeds will go towards our mission work at the Foundation for Education, and we're going to be hosting our event at the Stratford Festival in the Marquee Room. So it's going to be a silent auction dinner. There's going to be lots of promotion of artwork and some entertainment, so it's going to be a good night, and if you're able to come on out, we'd appreciate the support.
I can include that as well. Thanks, Laura.
Thanks.
Great. I think that's a good fulsome key takeaway. It kind of covered most of the key points from the meeting this evening. So that's perfect. Thank you.
Excellent. Thanks, Shara. So if everyone just wants to take note there of the upcoming meeting dates, we've got January 31st, April 3rd, and May 29th. Are we looking to host any of them in person this year, or are we looking to continue with the platform of Zoom or Teams?
I think we definitely get better.
January 31st.
I think we definitely get better attendance when we have them hosted online, because people can pop on and then and off really easily. If we were to host
April
in person,
April 3rd.
Sorry, Adrian, I'm just going to put you on mute. We would be hosting in Seaforth, which might be really convenient for some, but really inconvenient for others. So, I mean, I think it's maybe the will of the group if those wanted to come together in person. I don't mind putting together a quick little Google form. Shauna says Teams is definitely the preference. I know it's hard, and it's much easier just to quickly jump on your phone or your computer for a quick meeting than factor in the driving. But there is also value in meeting in person and putting, you know, a face to the names and meeting them in person. There is value to that. So I don't mind putting together a quick Google form that says, you know, maybe our last meeting of the year, which would be the May meeting. I could say the suggestion has been to be in person. Would you come? Yes or no? And then we could see. And if the majority of the group says absolutely, then sure. If not, then maybe we don't bother. But it's the will of the group, I would say.
Okay, that sounds great. Thanks, Shara.
Yeah, and there's also the suggestion for hybrid. So at our office in Seaforth, we can definitely accommodate hybrid. We can have people come in person, and then we can offer the online option, and we have a good speaker system, and I would say we're very well set up for the hybrid option. So I could add that to the I would be interested to see how many people would actually come in person, though, because then if we say four, then five, it may not be worth our effort. So I don't mind putting together a quick form just to gather input on that.
Okay, that would be excellent. Okay. So unless there's anything else that someone wants to raise at this point, I think this has been a very efficient meeting, which is nice and respectful of everyone's time. And look forward to seeing all those orange shirts. Thank you, everyone. Good night.
Thank you. Good night.
Thank you.
Night, everybody.
Good night.